It's here in Spring Hill, Nova Scotia. Through its people.
Well, the Rosemary Brown table is all smiles right now.
Through their struggles.
Do you worry about the ice?
What's going to happen if it all melts?
There's a story has been about.
Through their victories.
At stake today, Brian Mulroney's place in history and a document that will shape the country for generations to come.
We always ask what makes a Canadian.
Peter Mansbridge, CBC News.
Well, I've spent my career looking for the answers.
Jobs in Canada.
They've all worked the coal mines in Cape Breton. Now they sing to preserve the heritage and the folklore of the island's mining community.
I'm not making this up. I was watching your show last night.
Meeting some extraordinary people along the way.
Often with a crowd.
Being witness to extraordinary circumstances.
Good evening again from the Berlin Wall.
This week we're in Charlottetown to discuss the changing nature of news. Think satire.
Tremendous jabs.
Opinion. Tweets. 24-hour news channels.
Tax cuts to the middle class.
From Parliament Hill to war zones.
Protest against the Assad government.
To your backyard.
CBC News, Halifax.
How do we cover the stories that matter to you? And are we changing the way we do it? It all starts right now.
Well, good evening, Canada, as we stream live across the nation, Confederation Center of the Arts. What a crowd. Tickets for this event were gone in 48 minutes. Yes, indeed, and why not? My name is Bruce Rainey. I host a show called Compass here on PEI. It's the CBC Supper Hour News program here on the island. Again, welcome. What an esteemed panel we have here tonight. I'm going to take some time here to introduce them to you individually. We have Newfoundlanders on the wings tonight, which is unbelievable. But it's going to work. One of the great essayists in this country's history. To say he has a way with words would be phenomenal understatement. Mr. Rex Murphy. I missed her years ago in Halifax by about 2 months. She used to co-host the show called First Edition, the CBC Supper Hour News program in Nova Scotia, has gone on to become one of the premier foreign correspondents on this planet. Susan Ormiston. Watch this, watch this. From Cumberland, PEI. It is shameless, but it works. Say hi to Mr. Tom Murphy, the host of CBC News in Nova Scotia. Knocking it out of the park on a nightly basis on Power and Politics, Rosemary Barton. Woo-hoo! This won't be as big, but it's going to be good. You ready? From Sackville, New Brunswick. The host of Prime Time on CBC News Network, Ian Hanomansing. And on the far left, from a program you might have heard of. It's called This Hour Has 22 Minutes. It's a mystery why he's here, but he is. Mr. Mark Critch. It is now my distinct pleasure to welcome to the stage here at the Confederation Center of the Arts, I think the biggest compliment you could pay someone in our business is that he or she is exactly the same off-air as on. This is one class individual who has been a huge part of Canada, well, for my lifetime. I know he's going to love that. Anyway, he has been wonderfully generous to our Compass program and to me in particular over the past 13 and a half years. the host of the National in Conversation, your moderator tonight, Mr. Peter Mansbridge.
Thank you very much.
I knew they would be excited because they're seeing you for the first time right now tonight. Are you going to be okay? Because I can stick around and help. Otherwise, yeah. You feel okay?
I'm feeling, I've had a little bit of a cold this week. Ian's asked me, 40, 50 times already today if I'm sure it's okay.
Can you just clear up the one rumor that's all around PEI?
Which one?
This is the one. Everybody's talking about this. Is Boomer taking over for you?
He is. Boomer's coming to Toronto.
Right.
I'm coming to Charlottetown.
To do weather. Right. I'm going to clear up. Good to see you, pal. Have fun.
Thank you. I know how much you're going to miss these two guys, Bruce and Boomer, leaving at the end of April. So synonymous with this province, and so much a part of how you've been gathering information, both about the news and about the weather, for such a long time. Both two wonderful guys who I've been lucky enough to know for a long time. People ask me, why do you love this job? These are people who fill the reason for that, give me the answer for that. When you get to work with professionals like I get to work with on so many different levels, working is such a pleasure. Coming in to work with them, to introduce their stories and the way they do them, it's hard to beat that. They're great. And tonight you'll get the chance to hear their answers to some of your questions. We welcome to our audience, the 1,000 or so who are here in Charlottetown, we also welcome people across the country who are watching on YouTube and watching on Facebook Live, and they may also be in different parts of the world watching. If you're watching on Facebook Live or on YouTube, go to your comments section to fill in questions. The topic tonight, it's focused, but it's in some ways it's quite general. It's the changing nature of news. Your questions about that topic, we want to hear them. There's lots to go with on that. Everything, obviously, from satire, like Mark does, to the hard-edged reporting that takes place in Ottawa, that Rosie does, that Ian does, even from Vancouver to Ottawa and elsewhere. Susan's work overseas and here at home. Rex's opinions, Tom. His work in Atlantic Canada. So we want to get to your questions, and that's enough introductions, so let's get right to them now. And we'll take one from here in the room. Who's got it? Hillary, you've got one? Go ahead.
Hi there. Why must university college students cite their sources to avoid punishment and plagiarism, but journalists can have an opinion of fact without citing sources?
Oh, sure. We're going to start with the easy ones right away. That's a very good question. And the question, if you didn't hear it, we want to just work on those microphones, is basically, this fellow's a university student. He's writing a paper. He has to name his sources. We're journalists. There are circumstances, never our preferred option, but there are circumstances where we don't name our sources. So who do I go to for the question?
Mark.
To answer. Should we go? There's a lot.
I use Google myself.
Come on, Wikipedia.
We actually have a lawyer in Ian Hanomansing. Ian, what's your best crack at that one?
I like his, so go ahead. Well, our bosses don't make it easy to use unnamed sources. We don't like using unnamed sources. You want to have people out there who stand by who they are and are willing to be held publicly accountable. But obviously, there's situations where someone can only give you information with the understanding that they can't be identified. So, you know, the first step is verifying that that person who is an unnamed source is who he or she says they are. And our bosses have very strict requirements and say, look, you know, you have to prove to us that that person is real, does know the information they're telling you, so you satisfy that first thing. And I suppose a university student writing a paper could go through that verification process as well. It's the second phase of it that distinguishes us from a university student writing a paper, at least in most circumstances. And that is, we're in a situation, if our bosses agree for that unnamed source to remain unnamed, that if he or she were named, they either wouldn't give you that information or they would be put in danger, sometimes grave danger. And you can see that would be different from most university students most of the time. You could still give your professor that name, even if that person's a whistleblower, and make the case that you're not going to publish that paper and you'll keep it confidential between you and your professor. So I think that's why we have that latitude that we exercise very carefully and with great oversight, and perhaps a university student wouldn't.
All right. Hillary's got her second question, too, as well.
Thank you, and I apologize if I'm going to preempt what you folks might have been saying tonight. There's an ever-increasing speed with which the news is disseminated on things like Twitter and Facebook Live. My question is, does that speed to, or that pressure to get the story out first, impact the accuracy of that news reporting, and what does the CBC do to ensure the accuracy of those types of news reports?
Okay, that's a good question. You never have to say you're sorry to ask one. I first learned about Twitter from Susan Ormiston, who explained it to us, I don't know which election.
2008 election, Peter, this is how you tweet. Yeah. I had just learned it myself.
So Susan's our in-house expert on that, and we've seen a lot happen in, you know, in the 8 years since then, 8 or 9 years since then, in terms of that very question, the speed and the question of accuracy on social media, how it impacts us.
Lightning speed, and yes, it does affect accuracy in the moment, for sure. News has become breathless, breaking. We can't ignore it. We can't sit back and not report something. What we can do and do is go back and verify and make sure that if there was an inaccuracy that we tweeted out or blogged out or put on Facebook, that it is corrected. The great thing about the internet is other people are helping us do that. It's this massive voice out in the world who's saying, you got that wrong. Now, they may be trying to distract me from the truth as well, so you have to double up and look again. But I think in the main, what the benefit of social media has brought to us as journalists is more voices. Many, many more voices. So if something is breaking, there's lots of material coming in, and absolutely we have to verify and check, and you learn how to make sure that sources are good, but you're going to get caught up. I'll give you a very recent, quick example of the shooting at the mosque in Quebec City last month. I happened to be in Moscow. It was 3 a.m. I woke up, reached my phone. It's a bad habit. And my Twitter was going crazy with the news of this event. And I saw a tweet from Reuters breaking news. Reuters is a well-respected international foreign agency that we depend on a lot for news. And it said that already 2 white supremacists from America had been captured in that shooting, and I thought, wow, that was pretty quick. And I realized, thankfully did not retweet it, realized within minutes, people saying that's a fake site. It was Reuters new break, and break was spelled wrong, but it had the same logo, the same font. So it's really tricky. You have to be really diligent to trust your sources. But in the end, with all of what we're discussing, unnamed sources, social media, what we hope that you take away from us at the CBC is that you do trust that we are trying to verify as much as we can in this expanding, exploding world.
All right. Mark Critch, I want you, before I ask you a question, I want the audience to watch what you're an expert at. And
it won't be very long.
Oh, you're a target now, Ian. Watch your monitors, and this is a recent 22 minute skit that Mark did. Watch this.
We go live to the White House, where the president is signing his latest round of executive orders.
Okay, this is a plan to ban travel from 7 Muslim countries. This is not a ban on Muslims. This is just a ban on Muslim people who are actively Musliming in tremendously Muslim countries like Mecca and Aleppo. And it's not a ban on the good Muslims like Muhammad Ali or Shaquille O'Neal or Dr. Oz. This is a ban on the kind of Muslims that look like they're from Muslim. But it's not a ban on Muslims.
Listen, I have a real question on that. But first, I got to ask you, because, you know, we've all seen a lot of Trump imitations. That is a really good one. Okay. And, you know, not... How many times do you have to sit in front of the mirror and practice that for you?
You know what? I kind of went about doing the Trump impression the same way Trump goes about things, just with bravado and confidence, without thinking about it too much. What happened was, the first time I did it, it was live in front of the audience, and I got the audience to stand up and said, just pretend you're at a rally. We had out signs. And I started talking and doing things. And the big thing about it, if you go forward, just keep talking, but it's all about the asides, like, isn't it? Wasn't that? It really was. And then he goes back. He just gets himself to agree with himself. But then the people behind me started going like, yeah! Get those people out of here! And I was like, what's going on? And it's like, and I'm like, this is how Hitler got started. You just hand out a couple of signs and people go crazy. So I fed off hate, Peter. That's how I did it.
Okay, here's the real question. Mm-hmm. How has your use of satire changed in the way you do it and the way it's accepted, not just by the television audience, but by the audience you're making fun of, really, in a meaningful way, or trying to in a meaningful way? How has it changed?
I think what's good is you get a very direct response from people. Right away, if I make fun of Justin Trudeau, people will say you're going too soft on them, and they'll also say that's not fair. And then if you make fun of a conservative person, all these people start yelling at you online, and they'll call you all kinds of names and say, oh, you're just working for Justin Trudeau, and the NDP are just happy to be around. But so you're very much aware of your and you get to have responses from people you're making fun of. Like recently, Scott Baio is a big supporter of Donald Trump, and he spoke at the Republican convention. I made a little joke about him. He starts tweeting at me and saying, "You're no Jay Leno," and then we have this dialogue about Canadian lefties and boo boo Americans. And then I invite him to come on the show, and we read each other's tweets to each other and saw how ridiculous the conversation was, and we agreed to dislike each other. So it gives you this access to make fun of someone and then have a dialogue with the people who hate you immediately.
Here's our first one coming in from social media. This was asked on Facebook by Michelle Ross Hickson from New Haven, Connecticut, but formerly from PEI.
Nice.
Here's Michelle's question. How do journalists work around their own biases? Tom, I want you to try and handle this. How do journalists work around their own biases? What sort of questions does a journalist ask themselves or their sources as they try to push through biases to get to the real story?
That is a really good question, because we all come to life with some sort of bias of some sort. We all have an opinion or a take on things, and you know, and the role of the journalist is to try and detach yourself from that. And I think, so for me, what I try to do when I'm reporting, if I have a thought about the way I think the world should unfold or is unfolding, the key is to ask all those people around you to try and challenge even your own thoughts or preconceived notions about what something is like. And then, of course, the idea is to try and roll that into your coverage if you can. Bias is, it can be deadly in our business. It really can, because you can find yourselves really, really in a corner on a story. You're talking about technology innovation. The neat thing about what's happening in the world right now with social media and the quick response is that you'll hear about it very quickly. If someone thinks you've brought bias to that story, whether you don't intend to, but if it should happen, then you're quickly told about it. And there's a real opportunity to bring that voice into the conversation. So for me, when I'm reporting, it's about bringing more voices into that conversation. And, you know, bias should not enter the equation.
All right. Got one for Rosie here. And there's probably no one sitting on this panel who has more interaction from the audience, especially through social media, than Rosie on her politics show at night, because they're, in some ways, it's a little like Mark was talking about.
You know, I thought he was describing my job.
Exactly. in terms of the reaction you get from both sides, yeah. Assuming you were working for the other side. Here it comes from Anne-Marie Oberg from Drayton Valley, Alberta. She asks on Facebook, are you told what you can or cannot broadcast, even if it's against your gut feeling that the public should know?
So no. That's the easy answer. People often ask as well if politicians get questions before an interview. The answer is also no. You know, a politician might say, I want to come on and talk about this announcement. We'll say, fine, but we're going to talk about other things too. And if they say, well, then we're not coming, we say, so long. It's as simple as that. We don't accept that other people put parameters around the journalism we're doing, because that would limit the answers that we need to get for all of you. And that's not acceptable. I would say the only place where maybe there would be a discussion about what should go to air is if there were graphic images. That conversation will take place. The shooting in Ottawa would be a good example. There were photos of the soldier dead in front of the memorial being resuscitated. There had to be a conversation about how often we wanted to use those pictures, why we were using those pictures, explaining why we were using those pictures, that kind of thing. But in terms of the content, no one else tells us how to tell the story. That would infringe upon our freedoms, and I think limit how well we could tell the story for all of you. So, and they try. Every politician, every party, all of them, all the time, try to control the way the conversation's going to go and the way an interview is going to unfold. The other thing that they do, both governments, the previous one and this one, is try and choose who's going to interview them. That's a little game they like to play too, because they think this person will know more about that or less about that, or this person's not going to know all the details. So they try and do that as well. And we also try and shut that down, because that's again, not going to help any of you get the answers that we think you deserve. So they can try, but they won't win.
Well, you know what they try to do isn't wrong.
No.
It's part of the process.
Irritating.
What's wrong? Yeah, irritating for sure. But what's wrong are journalistic organizations that succumb to it.
Yes.
You know, Rosie gave you a couple of examples of where our policy is very clear. Elsewhere, you know, parties will try to, you know, brown bag you material if you don't say where you got it from. You know, about the other parties.
Yes.
We're very strict on that. You know, we'll use it, but we're going to say where we got it from.
Okay.
And if they're not willing to play with that rule, then we're not using it.
Yeah.
So, you know, in some ways that goes back to the question about unnamed sources, but it's a very particular case. Okay, we've got another question here, and Joanne has got the questioner with her.
My question is, with the proliferation of alternative facts that has happened throughout media, what is journalism's responsibility to us, the general public, to call out when a lie is a lie?
You know, you could probably get six different opinions on this, because the use of the L word is one that raises, you know, real questions for some people. Rex hasn't spoken yet. I know he feels strongly about this, but we're going to start with Susan first.
I'll be quick.
Okay.
We've been asked to be as candid as we should be with all of you, and we should be in our reporting. Sometimes I want to say to a person I'm interviewing, that's a lie. Usually I choose another way to say that's not the truth. And I think it's a better way, likely, to say it. But I think we all should be a little bit more honest about calling out lies. We can frame it with a different word, perhaps, but when it isn't the truth, we need to nail it. And I often think that that's why my kids watch Mark Critch more than they watch me, because he actually says, come on, that's not the truth, you know it isn't, and I don't say it enough or well enough or in a way that they can understand. So I think it's something that we need to grapple with and talk about a bit more. We have to be sure of our facts, though. We Right. cannot be caught out.
Right.
Well, I want to point out one thing is that it isn't a new phenomenon, and it doesn't begin with Facebook or Twitter. If you want to go back to a classic example, William Randolph Hearst, who was probably the first inventor of Twitter, even though it took 80 years to catch up to him, he famously said of the Spanish War, Franco, you get me the photographs, and I'll give you the war. And that was the biggest journalist in all of the United States. On the question of whether journalists per se should call out lies, I don't think of myself as a journalist. I have the same relationship to journalism as a streetwalker does to the Department of Highways. When I, in the spot that I'm allowed to have, it is opinion, and you know I'm foolish to begin with, so if I say strong things, it's forgiven. Mark is the satirist, and so therefore if he calls something a lie, it's coming from a slightly different context than from the authoritative voices of established journalists. One last thought, and it's one that should be very deeply taken. Before we, in a journalistic capacity, correspondents, anchors, anybody, before we are so sure of our own thoughts on all things, and as long as we are sure that we're not feeding our perception when we call a lie, if the lie is so stark, and if you cannot, on the evidence, trust the public to see that it is a lie, that might be an occasion for you to become the declarer. But the best situation is all the information that we have, we pass to you, and we let your adult judgments make the call to the great big L word.
Yeah, see, part of the problem here is a lie truly defined is when you knowingly deceive. The problem is the knowingly part, because you're never really sure if they were absolutely aware that they were deceiving. That's where it gets tricky.
But or they believe it.
Or if they believe it.
Or they're Kevin O'Leary.
You see. Okay. All right.
I couldn't say that.
No.
I'd get Rosa fired.
Couldn't say
I'd get
that.
Fired.
That was me, Kevin.
Yeah. So, Mark,
yeah.
Do you use the L word? Do you call somebody you believe to be a liar a liar? Do you do that?
Oh, I have done that. Yeah, we had Kevin O'Leary on last year when he first announced. I had him on, and he was Mr. Wonderful with his backdrop behind him. He was saying all kinds of things that wasn't true, and I made fun of him and called him a liar, and now he won't come back on. But so you had to be careful there. But that's just my opinion. But I find in an interview, you can kind of get away with it. You don't even have to say it, because you can kind of say, really? Come on. And that flash of truth on the person's face will kind of give it away.
Yeah, I was just, obviously, I encounter this often. Not people lying, people misleading, being a little bit loose with the interpretation of things. I think there's a couple things. I don't think there are some facts that are not disputable. Mm-hmm. It's our job to know the facts well enough to be able to say, that's not true. And I will say that. I will say that's not true. Or I will say, you are purposely being misleading. I will never say.
What's the hesitation in using the L word? If you're going to say it's not true, why would you say it's a lie?
It's your point. It's your point. Are they doing it on purpose and knowingly? And the other point is this: liar is a real trigger word.
Yes.
Right. If you call someone a liar, that's it. Now we are into it, and it's going to happen. But if I say, I don't really think that's my understanding of the facts. Well, then you all understand that I've understood that the person's lying, but I haven't gotten up in their grill and said it to them, right? That's the difference.
That's why he won't go on Mark's show anymore.
I haven't interviewed him yet, so he's...
You haven't interviewed him yet?
No, I can't wait.
Oh, it's a treat.
Okay.
We'll sell tickets to that one.
Yeah.
Okay, Ian, this question is for you.
How do you know that?
You have skills that
I planted it.
Complex issues that are facing the Canada and the world today in our short attention spans of the 2-minute YouTube video and the short blog and Twitter.
I don't know. You know, I often tell people that when they come home at the end of the day and somebody at home asks them what happened today, they do a couple of things that are skills that we try to develop as well in news. First of all, is identifying kind of what's the big story. So just in your life, what do you tell them? And then secondly, how long does it take to tell them that story? You know, you go through your work day, you deal with, you know, all the things that all of you have done today, wherever you've been, and you could tell that story in an hour. Or, you're right, I'm going to be a target for sure. But anyway, or you can tell that story in a few sentences, right? So I think that is one of the skills. And it's interesting, actually, for both Rosemary and I, because you were a reporter for years, as was I, and you try to boil down a complex issue, a complex story to 2 minutes with clips and that sort of thing. And all of a sudden, we have much longer on our programs to look at the same issues. On Wednesday, for example, with the terror attack in London, the first probably 25 minutes of our show was on that, and it allowed us to deal with it from different angles, different nuances. But at the same time, I mean, Susan knows this, she could do a story in 2 minutes, efficiently, think it out beforehand. Tom as well.
Done a story in 2 minutes.
Tom could do a story in 2 minutes. So there's a skill to that, and sometimes you lose a little bit of the complexity, but it's amazing how much of a story you can tell in a short period of time.
All right. Thank you very much for that one. Brian Andrew asked this on Facebook. What steps do you take to capture the attention of different age groups and youth in particular? And Susan, you try this, aside from going longer than 2 minutes. How has that evolved over the past 20 years, and does it work?
It's challenging. I remember asking my son, having returned from Syria, what he thought of my stories, and he said, "Afraid not, I didn't see them." He was about 16. But he said, "I know all about Syria," because he had a YouTube influencer that he was watching every night who would say, "This is what's happening in Syria. Assad's doing this, the opposition's doing this," and I was heartbroken. So it is a challenge to reach out to all different age groups and diverse people, the audience. But, you know, I think this is the time we're living in now. It's such an opportunity because we have so many ways now. So we're on Facebook Live tonight. We're not going to be on the National. And I think our audience will be broader than it would be on an average night at the National. So I think now with this explosion of media, we have the opportunity to reach out to different groups. And we also have the opportunity for them to tell us our stories. One of the big gains of social media and the digital revolution is that we have many more voices and fewer gatekeepers. When I started out in this business with Peter, you know, the National decided what we were going to do every night, and that was a prime source of information for many people. Now they get it from so many different places. So that's a gain.
And, you know, we are trying to use the tools of a younger generation, especially millennials, who are monitoring us digitally for the most part, not in traditional methods. I mean, many nights on the National now, I take questions live on Facebook Live in a commercial break on the National. The questions often don't have a lot of substance to them. They're more like, "Hey, are you wearing shorts or are you wearing pants?"
But the answer is.
But the beauty of it is there's a connection there in terms of your audience. And, you know, I make light of it, but there are a lot of substantive questions as well. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I was in Vimy Ridge preparing for our programming for the 100th anniversary, and we were doing it with Google, with YouTube, And we were using technology that I've certainly never used before. I mean, the biggest deal in my life was when we went from black and white to color. And now, suddenly, here I was wearing a Google Trekker on top of my head, walking through the trenches, taking, you know, all kinds of...
Are there pictures?
Oh, there are pictures. It's, you're going to love it when we show it to you. But we have to engage that audience, we have to do what they're doing. It doesn't affect our journalism in the sense we're still adhering to our principles and policies and all that, but we're using technology that many of us have never used before, and it's great. You know, it's really turned the corner for us.
Wait a sec. What were you wearing on your head?
It's called a trekker. You know what? You can go to Google and find your house and the drive-by, the car, the Google car. Google Maps.
Yeah.
Well, they do a walking version of that thing. Where you wear the thing, you look. Remember what Al Franken used to look like on Saturday Night Live with the satellite dish on his head? It kind of looks like that. And you walk around, and there's, you know, 16 cameras in the thing.
You sure it wasn't a practical joke?
Why?
just wear this, Peter. All the kids are doing it now.
Yeah.
Will they have your voice for Google Maps? How do I get to the mall? Tonight, your journey begins, but first, Rex Murphy on the neighborhood.
I can't win. We have a question here in the audience. Go ahead.
People will argue about this, but the CBC has managed to remain pretty tame when it comes to sensationalized news. So how do you think we avoid getting to a place where the CBC has to rely on catchy headlines or something to generate revenue with certain calls and a certain leadership race to privatize the CBC? If you could just talk about that.
Peter?
Yeah, well, you know, we're not in the business, those of us here, the journalists, here, we're not in the business to capture revenue. We're in the business to bring information to you so you have a better understanding of your world. And every time we would go over the top in telling you the story, it's hurting us, not helping us. And, you know, we know that that's a conscious decision for us. You know, we consider news as what's important for you to know, and we tell it the best way we can, using the most engaging methods we can. Television isn't always an easy medium to translate complicated topics. So you have to be imaginative, and I give you an example just a moment ago. It really worked well, too, with this crowd. but you know, I hope we never go that sensationalist route. We are at a crossroads here, in terms of the national, at least, as it's going to be changing. You know, I'm leaving. We're using this opportunity, as we should, to think about all the different possibilities that the new national could be. But at its core, while it should be ambitious and it should have a sense of risk and it should use new techniques, at its core it will still be and should be adhering to all the principles that are important to us in terms of our journalism. Ian. What do you think?
I would say there's a continuum, right, between on the one end where the news organization stands back, is gray, doesn't change at all, and everything in news is very serious. On the far end are the tabloids that are constantly thinking about pandering to an audience, but it is a continuum, and we need to find our place on that continuum. Definitely not to pander, but at the same time, not to be so arrogant that we're going to sit back and pronounce the news to you and tell you the only things we think are important and not listen to you. I remember when the Globe and Mail went from having black and white pictures to color pictures, there were angry letters to the editor of people saying, you're pandering to the audience by having color pictures on the front page.
But they were Globe readers.
But, you know, so the thing is that it is important that, I remember the O.J. Simpson debate, 1994, 1995. I was watching that trial, and not for the entertainment value, although there were times when it was entertaining, but I found it fascinating. There were a lot of other people that looked at the O.J. coverage as being a case of pandering to the lowest common denominator. So the answers aren't easy, you know. You do fancy headlines with music, there are going to be some traditionalists who feel that that is somehow giving up on what the CBC should do. So we have to, you know, there's a line in that old movie Broadcast News from 1988, They're talking about ethics in that case. It's a movie, it's not real life. But William Hurt says, you know, they keep moving that line all the time. And it's the same thing with how we deal with our news judgment, our lineup, our choices, our use of animation, the techniques that we do, having the anchor walk around with what he thinks is a camera on his head. You know, so it keeps changing, but hopefully, I think you've seen this, you know, we have to stay true to the basic, this might be my last day on the newscast, but anyway, we have to stay true to kind of the basic principles.
They did tell me, the thing weighed about 70 pounds, they did tell me, oh, this just arrived, Ian and Rosie sent it to you. Okay, question, next question. Actually, the best way to do this is to show a clip of a piece that Susan did in, I believe it was in Syria. Watch this.
We're showing the face of the resistance. Young, defiant, fearless. During the day, the army infiltrates this town, but at night, the protesters own it. Every night it's the same. In the suburbs of Damascus, people group, come, and protest against the Assad government. They've been doing this for months and say they'll continue until the regime falls. Thousands have been taken from here, still 300 in custody.
We hide our face because we are afraid. One guy, he's dead.
Wow. All right, I'm sure that... So there's actually a couple of questions for you on this. And the first one, a quick one, is how important is it to be on the ground to tell that story?
Critical.
Yeah.
It's critical to be on the ground in any place, not just in Syria, but here, in many places in Canada. It's critical. You can, I have been saying this for years, Peter, you know it. You get so much more information, you get a better lens when you're there, because how do we all communicate and tell stories? We pick up all kinds of clues that aren't in text, that aren't in a little vision of video. I'm getting so much information from what's around me in that scene, for example, that I come away better informed, which helps me tell you a clearer perspective of what the story is.
All right, here's the question that follows up that from I think this came in on Facebook. Jake Din, who's from here in St. John's. St.
Everybody go, quick!
Kind of feels like St. John's up here. At the...
Mark, we did it again.
Yeah, I tell you. Yeah, I tell you. Anyway, Jake Din, sent all across the teletype from St. John's.
I set it up.
He asked, some civil wars, like Syria, are covered widely in the media. Yeah, they're covered widely, but not the way Susan was talking about, by actually being there. But others, like Yemen, do not receive as much coverage. How can the CBC work to ensure the coverage of as many of these issues as possible? What are the limitations to covering some of these stories?
Well, the limitations are budget, security, interest, those are the main ones.
Tell them about security, because I think most people don't realize that when you go into a situation like that.
Yeah, I mean, that clip that you just saw in brief, we had to ditch our Syrian minder, who went home at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, dropped us off at the hotel and said, we'll see you tomorrow, Susan. And I said, yes, we'll. And then we start our real work, which is getting out of the hotel, doing a series of passwords with taxis, we were hoping were on our side, to get to the suburbs of Damascus to be in that situation. It's very risky, and you try to manage the risk. So that's one issue, but that's part of telling the story. The second issue is budget. It's expensive to go, less expensive than it was because of this marvelous thing that we have, these types of things, which we can connect now to anywhere, really, in the world. If I'm there, I can go live as long as I have an internet or a cell phone signal. That has changed my job enormously, so that's a positive. But I think the main thing is that I really need to hear from you about what you want to know. So yes, Syria is a big story now, but that was 2011, and we didn't cover it very much between 2011 and 2014. all the time this war was getting horribly terrible and complex and more actors coming in. So we do need to listen more carefully to what people want to hear. It's not just about what we think you need to know about news, is what are you interested in that we can help you sort out, that we can try to translate in this complex world. So I'm very much for hearing from people about whether they want us to be in Yemen or they want us to be in Summerside or where we need to go for where the stories are.
All right, back of the room here, a question in the audience.
Hi. Over the last year, we've watched, particularly south of the border, but also here in Canada, things become speakable that weren't necessarily previously part of sort of the spoken social contract. And increasingly, if journalism covers the things that are the most extreme views, are you contributing to the polarization of a society to a point where we don't necessarily, we're not able to get back to a place where we have things in common or can find things in common?
That's a good question. Rosie. Well, you have to deal with this a lot.
Yeah, I think the danger of not giving voice and listening to some of the things that you're talking about is that it ignores people who are feeling things or become increasingly disenfranchised by society. After the American election, and even towards the end, I started to realize that I wasn't reading any of the media sites that the people who liked Donald Trump were reading. That's a problem. That's a problem for me, because then it means that my lens on what was happening was limited. So I started to read Breitbart. I started to look at some of those different kinds of further right websites and papers so that I could at least understand what they were talking about. That said, I don't think you have to put alt-right views, as they're called, neo-Nazis, people who are racists on television. I don't think you have to do that. But I think if you ignore it, the problem doesn't go away. And part of our job, and part of a political reporter's job, I think, is, even though it's very hard sometimes in Ottawa, but that's where Twitter does really help me, is to make sure I hear all of the voices. Not the voices that you would expect to listen to CBC, not the people who know how to send me an email, but all the people in between. And sometimes just listening to someone, I think, validates their existence. And that's also part of my job. And it doesn't mean that we say it's okay to be racist or it's okay to have those views. That is now socially acceptable. But I do think that closing our ears and our eyes to it is not the right thing to do. I mean, Kelly Leach is a good example, right? I'm sure that's who you were thinking of as well. She wants to have this values test for people coming into the country. Well, you know, you have two ways to go about this. You can either ignore Kelly Leach and say, that's a crazy idea, that's not Canadian, knowing that there's some people giving her money and supporting the idea, or you can go to Kelly Leach and say, what does that mean? How are you gonna do that? Why do you think that's important to Canadians? Who are you actually targeting? That, to me, is a much more responsible thing to do as a journalist. Call her out, ask her to name it, ask her to explain it, so that we all know what we're dealing with. Because again, I think you have to expose things in order to understand them.
I'd add one thing that if I could. We should distinguish between judgment and analysis.
That's right.
The biggest error in journalism in the last 10 years at least was the North American coverage of the Trump election. Even the New York Times was 92% on the night of the election. If because of our distaste or presumed distaste for a set of opinions, we decide not to explore them at all and get them not only from the leader, but from the people who actually feel them, we're cutting off a tremendous range of experience, and therefore we're limiting the value of the journalism that's going out. I'll say this as a personal kind of thing. It really is sad that the profession that exists to know its people could so seriously get wrong the cardinal election of the entire planet. And down in the United States, the fact that journalists could not perceive on the night of the campaign that it was even possible he might win, that speaks a lot of problems. So it making the judgment that the point of view wasn't good enough to cover impaired the analysis. Whereas if they'd allowed tolerance of those views, they would have known how big they might have been.
Right.
All right, Dawn. But let's not forget, they did give him an 8% chance of winning. So they did have that base covered.
HuffPo went 97%. Yeah. Always read HuffPost.
Yeah. I want to ask Mark on this question, and I thought about it specifically when Rosie mentioned the Kelly Leach example, because you're not shy about going after these people and giving them airtime as a result of that.
Yeah.
So what is your reasoning for doing that?
I get that too. I mean, you look at our Facebook page, and there, I'll do something about Kelly Leach or someone, and then people say, please don't do this, please don't make fun of this person because it'll be spread around, and you're giving oxygen to the fire, and the same thing with Trump. It's very funny what you do, but please stop doing it because you're making light of it. And you know what? I think people should see this stuff, and a lot of times people will watch our show who don't watch the news at all. They get some of our news. From it's true. People come up and say, I started watching the news because I liked your show. <That's true. laughs> And the other thing I get is a lot of new Canadians will come up to me and they say, we came to Canada, and somebody said, if you want to get a good mix of Canadian stuff, if you watch your show, you see like the Prime Minister, Tim Hortons parody, an Air Canada joke, and that's about it, you know? And that's the truth. But then people say, please stop making fun of these people. And it's like, well, look, what we do is we're looking at the week that was, and you had to show people things, and you had to make fun of these things. I always think of Charles Chaplin before the Second World War. People weren't really putting that much focus on Hitler. He did a whole film called The Great Dictator, making fun of Hitler, because he thought this whole thing was ridiculous. The first time he ever spoke on film was making fun of Hitler before the war even happened. Not to say that I'm a Chaplin or Kelly Leach's Hitler, but... but I think
it's... Let's try to do this without going there.
Okay. Sorry, Adolf, but... No, I'm kidding. But you have to, saying that hide under the bed and don't think about this stuff. You're doing yourself a disservice, and you're doing everybody else a disservice too, because you need to know what's actually happening in the country.
Peter. Okay,
that's okay.
All right.
Peter will not ask me anything else now.
No. All I'll add on that topic is that I talked to Tony Blair a month or 2 months ago. And he was interesting because what he said is part of the problem in this story and the way we go about this story is that in politics, there appears to be no middle ground anymore.
Right.
You're either over here or you're over here. And those are the voices you're tending to hear because there's no kind of recognized or credible voice in the middle. Now, I think he was mainly saying that because he's trying to put himself back into the picture. But you know, he may have had a point too, because we see it a lot. We see it in Ottawa. We see it in Washington. We certainly see it in parts of Western Europe. So it's an interesting part of this. Moving on, we go to Carolyn Pierce, and let's see, who would be best for this? Tom, I think you would be.
We need the Google helmet.
Carolyn Pierce. You know. They're now going to think this was total.
Yeah, we are.
It's real, and you're going to be happy when you see it. Carolyn Pierce asked this on Facebook, Tom. Is the news release dead? What's the best way to get your story in front of the reporter and hopefully picked up by the media in general? She's writing from Truro.
Good question.
Yeah, that is a good question. I don't think the news release is dead. We still get them in our newsroom all the time, and they get looked at, and people are pushing something they think is a story that they think should be on a supper hour show or on the national, and so that's an avenue for them. But increasingly, I would say it's becoming less important. I mean, more of my time as a journalist is spent watching my Twitter feed, you know, checking out what's happening on Facebook, because there are so many more voices. You have access to many more people there and things that are happening in the community. And a lot of times, what I'm finding is happening is the story is already happening or being told somewhere on social media. And, you know, as conventional broadcasters, we can often spend a lot of time running trying to catch up. But by the same way, a press release, you might get it, you might toss it in the waste paper basket at work because you're not interested, you don't think it's gonna be a story. A story like a bomb threat, for example, which can happen on Twitter, can be told first on Twitter and can spread like wildfire, and you folks know in PEI about the recent bomb threats at schools. There was a time when maybe a CBC newsroom wouldn't do the bomb threat story based on not having enough evidence or not really real, you know, if they thought that the risk wasn't great enough.
Or if we thought it was, it simply wasn't true.
Right.
I mean, that's basically our policy. But social media has changed.
It's changed it. I mean, and so you have a bomb threat can be quickly disseminated on social media. All schools can be put out, as they were in the province and PEI. It's hard to ignore that story.
Sure.
So that becomes a very well-trodden avenue for stories to come to a newsroom and eventually make them on the show like the National.
You know, Rex has a theory, and I'll get him to expound on it in a second, which is that we don't talk to real people enough. Mm-hmm. That in fact, we do still, whether it's the news release or what have you, we're not getting out of the newsroom and talking to people. Let me show you, so this is Rex's favorite clip. It's from 1994. I know that half this panel wasn't even born then, but...
Love you,
but you, yeah, but you watch this. Watch this clip, and he'll explain why it's his favorite.
You're a fisherman.
I'm a fisherman.
And that's your set of skills. Where else can they be used?
I don't see anywhere else, Rex, that they can be used. Only into the fishery. I can go in on the store loft. I got my stage and store in there. I got a full of the gillnets. I can show you right now. Cod traps, gillnets, trawls. Boats. I got a boat, 27 footer in here on the stage. Thinks just as much about her as I do about the woman. Got to say it. Thinks just as much about it, sir.
She'll be pleased.
Eh? She'll be pleased when she sees me on camera, but I mean, that's what I got to say. I mean, you know, deep down in my gut today, there's a knob and a tear in my eye to look out, like I said, where I once belong and don't belong there anymore.
Come on, he was set up.
Well, tell you the story if you want in 30 seconds.
I've never told a story.
No, I can't. Met him on a Thursday. He's next to Lancer Meadow, the great north site, and he was screaming through the CBC van that the CBC and Cornerbrook weren't covering him. And he had tried for years. We went back to St. John's. It was another story. We got reassigned. We get back to St. Anthony 2 days later. Now, he's swearing at me like Judas would have sworn after they carted him off to the nether regions. 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning, I tapped on his door. He came out with that cap on and his long johns. And he said, "You." And I said, "Yeah, me. You wanted the interview? Get out here." And so he comes out capped like this. But to go to the clip and to go to your point, I don't think you've seen a man speak poetry that well. Never confuse so-called education or illiteracy with articulation. I don't know if he had grade 3 or if he didn't, but that man had a PhD in talking. Yeah. And but to Peter's real point, and it will be succinct, the fact that you could find him, imagine what he said written down on a piece of paper. There's nothing in it. You see him, the ice is behind him, the Labrador's literally on his back shoulder. You see the vigor of him. You see his face, which is telling the story, too. There's so much content in live connection with the human being who's not only living the story, he is the story. And all the Twitters and all the Facebooks and all the internet connections that you can multiply by 20,000 will never be as rich as a guy you got out of bed at 10 o'clock in the morning who never thought you were going to come there.
Question from right here in the audience.
Hi there.
there. My question is for Rex Murphy, and I'd like to ask him, what are your fears for journalism for the future, and what are you optimistic for?
That it will continue. No. My fears for it is, Peter has already touched on it, I think is probably the key point of the entire evening. It's not that in the old days we were housekeepers of respectable point of views. Is that over the combination of technology and the advance of the times, we have splintered. We are one country. We continuously praise our immense and wonderful diversity, but it's commonality that is lacking. It are the themes that bring us all together, regardless of where we are from. And I find that news nowadays is a self-selected thing. You'll go on your favorite internet sites, and you'll read only what you wish to hear or you're already familiar with. The kind of violent reaction to some of the elections that we've had are precisely because we've put ourselves in silos and we're not even aware of the people who we dislike are thinking. And this means a breakdown in trust both in government and in journalism. The second thing is we often get fascinated with journalistic techniques. Again, Peter's point is correct. Going out to where the people are, don't fantasize what they think. And especially as journalists, we are a class. The idea that we are in any way better to judge things than that guy you just saw there, or some guy with a PhD, is nonsense. Democracy is the judgment of all, and we are not a class passing judgments on anybody. But we seem to have something of a gatekeeper. The worst thing of all, and this is probably difficult to say in certain contexts, I think identity politics is hiving people off into very intense convictions about a limited arena of experience. And that's driving news in parts. I would much rather see, and it isn't the new media that's doing this, but I would much rather see a greater emphasis on commonality. We have the play Come From Away now. It's on a New York Broadway stage. It's about a Newfoundland town, but it is the Canadian story. There's no place in this country where hospitality isn't readily available. That's the common element, whether we're natives, Sikhs, people born in Irish town, or even, God forbid, Mark Critch.
Well, I'll tell you a fast story about working in the newsroom in Ottawa when I was a reporter back in the 1980s. And we had a pretty good newsroom. It reflected newsrooms of that day. It was all men, and which was a problem, obviously. But there were some pretty good reporters there. And one of them used to say, mainly because he always turned up late for work, but he used to say, there are no stories in the newsroom. They're all out there. You're going to sit in the newsroom, you're not getting any stories. Real stories. You're going to do press releases and handouts and this and that. You got to get out to get the story. You know who that reporter was?
I'm going to guess.
Yeah.
Can
yeah,
I?
Yeah, you guess.
Yeah. Mike Duffy?
Mike Duffy. Here's the next question.
So what's the lesson there?
And the lesson is if you don't have a story wait around long enough, Mike Duffy will give you one.
The gift that keeps giving. Go ahead.
I wanted to ask you a question about the term fake news. Mm. It's nothing new, but we do see an uptake of public figures using the term fake news to combat news coverage that they don't like. I'm wondering what you do to try and counter that. And secondly, I'm wondering if you think we're going to reach a tipping point where the public won't fall for it, or they'll continue to. Which way is it going to go?
Well, you know, the part of the problem with fake news is there's so many ways to define it, you know, and it keeps expanding in that definition of what is fake news. But clearly, it's an issue that confronts us all and has for a long time, but especially so in the last year or so. Susan has seen fake news from a number of different angles, especially in this last year because of her various times she spent in Moscow. But in the general point, that this person is raising? How do you answer?
Yeah, I mean, thank you for your question, which you've partly answered, and I'm thrilled to hear that, that, you know, I do worry that we are not going to get to a tipping point where people discard it. I worry it's gaining strength, and it makes me angry, to be quite honest, because fake news is a smoke and mirrors game for exactly as what you describe, people who don't like what we're reporting. And fake news has been around forever. It's called spin. It's called propaganda. It's not new in any way. It's just a new name for it. In the only good thing about fake news is it's required all of us to be even more diligent in being transparent about how we get your news, about how we do it, who we ask, removing any existing smoke and mirrors, and that I think is worthwhile. But I worry about it a lot because I spend a lot of time defending my profession, which I've been doing for a long time, and I have never reported fake news knowingly ever. I have been misled and needed to redress that. But this idea that, you know, some person in Macedonia running a fake news site is making you think that's the real news, it makes me slightly crazy, to be quite honest. And we do have to deal with it well.
Okay. We got a related question here on, coming in on Facebook. Ian, you tried. Pat Painter, does the 24-hour news cycle and the race for breaking news and ratings have anything to do with the avalanche of fake news we're getting from mainstream media? You know, I'm not sure there's an avalanche of fake news on mainstream media, but the issue is there and the question is a legitimate one.
I think every time you have a different way of disseminating the news, you have people who are quick to be negative about it. So, for example, you know, when I was growing up in Sackville, university town, as you know, with Mount A, I mentioned this on the morning radio show today, there were people who were disdainful about television. They didn't like television. This is a long time ago, right? And so, you know, social media comes along. There are people who dismiss social media as being bad. The 24-hour news cycle dismissed by some people as being bad. Every medium has its good and its bad, and there are certainly news channels that need to fill their 24 hours with exciting headlines and breaking news perpetually, and I think those channels would be susceptible to filling some of that space with, if not fake news, then certainly news that is contorted and exaggerated, right? But it's not 24-hour news that creates the problem, it's bad journalism that creates the problem. It's bad judgments. I mean, we've all been, or in the course of our careers, you know, we've made mistakes, humans make mistakes, but I think on balance...
Wait a minute.
You didn't call the room, did he?
You never made a mistake.
I don't know what he's talking
about. No. Some of us even... I'm not going to make the joke about that, the thing on your head again. But, you know, pretty big mistake, right? So 24/7 news is not the problem. Bad journalism is the problem, right? And I think that, I mean, this is a partisan crowd for CBC, but it's true of CTV, The Globe, all the major news organizations. We make, on balance, good judgments, right? And whether it's CTV News Channel or CBC News Network, we can go through our 24-hour news and not succumb to bad journalism. And again, I give you back the example, and it happens all the time, but most recently on Wednesday, having an hour-long program that can turn on a dime allowed our program to make a judgment at the last moment to spend 20 or 25 minutes right off the top on that London attack and do it in a way that, for example, the National would look at it in a different way and do, you know, different news pieces with different reporters. So there are a lot of things about 24-hour news that I really like. When something big happens, if I'm not at work, sure, I'm looking at my phone, but I'm also sitting in my living room flipping around from channel to channel. And I think back to a time when news was developing and you waited for the morning newspaper or the afternoon edition of the newspaper or the radio show the next morning, and there was nothing in between. So let's not confuse 24-hour news with bad journalism.
He's got a photo of the thing.
Yeah, there's only so much I can take from this. How can those cameras zoom in? How close can you get?
This is the saddest spectacle I've ever seen.
They're not seeing it.
I really am.
It's really bad.
It's a real thing on my head.
Well, it's a real thing, yeah.
So I won.
So when will we see the pictures from this?
Soon. April 7th.
April 7th,
and then April 9th is the big Vimy Day, the 100th anniversary. And it does bring you, the whole idea is bring people closer to the story in a way they've never been there before. Never mind.
We'll see.
Okay. Question in the audience here.
I was just wondering, what is the process of determining what is shown in the media, and why is there such negativity?
Okay, that's two questions, and that's okay, you know, because there is a process how we decide what is news and what isn't news, and this whole question of why do you only report bad news, or why is there so much bad news in the part of most newscasts is also a legitimate question, and we do hear both of these a lot. And that's why Tom Murphy is here tonight. Because he's going to explain it to you.
You get that a lot from people who say, you know, it's the news is so depressing or the news is bad, and why do you cover that? Terrible to make a blanket statement, but I think a lot of times we cover those things because they're important. Because maybe they need to have a light shone on them. And because someone's life has been affected by what's happening in that story, so we have to tell that story. Speaking as someone who works for the national and tries to get stories on a national stage, determining what stories get told, it can be a challenge to get, let's say, stories from this part of the country on a national newscast. That to get that story told, you know, you're competing with what's happening in Syria or what's happening in Ottawa, Donald Trump, and so on. You know, I think what we try to do is to get those stories told is find a story that's universal in some way that people can recognize or see themselves in. And, you know, it's kind of how I made my living at the National, trying to tell people about this part of the country, the good and the bad. And there's some nights you couldn't get on the National with a story that maybe you thought was a burning issue in this one community because you're competing against other stories. But there's lots of nights you can. And you keep pushing to get that story on, and it's happened many times, and Peter and the desk have been very good about getting this part of the country on for that reason. Sometimes you tell the good news story. You tell something that reflects a way of life here or something that other people don't see in the rest of the country. Rex's interview there, you know? So I think those are how you try and get the stories. We as journalists, we push for stories every day to try and get stories told. And some of them are bad, some of them are going to be good, but hopefully through the course of time, you're getting sort of the full picture.
Can I jump in for just a second? I agree with what you say completely, but I think, you know, this idea of we hear it a lot. Why is there so much negative news? If we're hearing it a lot, we should be paying attention to it. Because maybe our audience has evolved and is looking for something different or a different balance. In my career, you know, the good news stories have always appeared at the end of the newscast. And I kind of bristle at good news stories. Because what I think does work and what you are interested in is inspirational stories. What Rex was speaking to, the commonality of experience. So maybe we do need to think about that a bit more and look for stories that are going to bring us together as we share the experience and have success and not call them good news stories and put them at the bottom.
Just so you can appreciate it, and I'm assuming most newsrooms operate the same way that ours do, whether they're the national or at the regional level in Halifax or here in Charlottetown, where it's not one person making these decisions about what's on the program, it's a group of people, senior editors for whatever that program is. And the differences of opinion, some of which you kind of heard there, are what you hear in those meetings every day on every lineup about what should be the top of the program, what should be the bottom, what should be in the middle, what should actually make it on the air, what shouldn't make it on the air. And what I tell young journalism students is you want to find yourself to be either working for a program or in a newsroom like that. If you don't hear that debate going on around you, then you're probably not in a good place. You want to hear discussion and debate, a lively debate about what should be on the program. And you'll hear it in a good newsroom because people are different. And you know, a friend of mine used to say, at the end of the day, there's not like a computer that sits there that you push the lineup of your program into and it pops out and says, hey, that was good, that was right, you got it all right. It's not like that. It's a very human decision by the people who are working on that program. And that's how you determine what programs you end up watching, by the decisions that are being made on a nightly basis, because most programs are different. You know, some days it's obvious what the lead is for everybody, but most days not like that. And the decisions being made in newspapers and television newsrooms, radio newsrooms, and online are different, and they reflect the kind of people that you see in that whatever particular newsroom it is. Here's a question from Facebook. MJ Phillips. When you're doing a live story such as 9/11, Parliament Hill shooting, how do you keep your emotions out of it and try to be objective? Well, you know, most of us have been in those situations, and I'll get others' view of it, but in some ways it's a luxury to be on the air because you're so focused on the story and trying to determine what happened and why it happened and what the latest developments are that you don't get caught up with the emotion of it. Rosie mentioned the Parliament Hill shooting and, you know, those who were, you know, by the monument at the time or immediately after it, that was a pretty emotional scene. Sitting in the studio trying to do it is a different kind of situation. Rosie was across the street in the shadow, right? It was as close as you could get, and they kind of had you locked in there. But your constant was trying to determine what the story was. What's the latest information?
Yeah.
And you're so focused on that, you don't get carried away. Ian, you're in this, you know, a lot, given your show at night and the number of hours you're on. How do you deal with that?
I'm not just saying this because you're here, but I the two anchors that I've learned the most from just simply watching, because I'm a big TV watcher, are Peter Jennings and you. And the thing that both of you have done over the years, Peter obviously, Jennings has passed away, but the ability to slow down and communicate. And there is a comfort as a listener when either of you have been on the air on big stories. And so earlier on in my career, I actually probably should admit this publicly, but consciously tried to, I wouldn't say mimic, but sort of think about how you would be and he would be in those situations. Then after a while, you develop your own style, and hopefully I've done that. And really now, the only key thing I try to do is not be Mark Critch.
I do that too, and Rosie, I really hope you get that job. Female anchor of the Nationals, it's about time.
Yeah. The one thing, yeah. I'll just add one thing about 9/11, because that day, for all of us, it was a challenging day and a different kind of day. And, you know, I ended up on the air, I think, for almost 44 hours straight. It was a break in the middle for an hour or two of sleep. But it wasn't until that break that it really struck home to me what had happened. I mean, I knew obviously the basic facts of everything that had happened. And I'd, you know, seen the images and had been telling the story nonstop for all that time. But it wasn't until I took the break, I went into my dressing room where there's a couch, you know, for those who may be interested in the in the future. And I lay down on that couch to grab a bit of rest, but I saw the little light flickering or blinking on my phone. And so I picked it up and there was a message there. And it was from my daughter, who is in Winnipeg. And she had phoned at some point in the evening, say, how are you doing? I just want to know, I've been watching, and I love you. And I thought, that's weird. I've never had a phone call like that from her before. But then I realized, well, that was happening everywhere. That was happening with people with their, you know, their relatives, their children, their grandparents, their friends in different parts of the world. It was happening that day because they'd all been overpowered by the story and by the images they were seeing on television. So there became this whole different connection to the emotionalism of the story as a result of that. And I think we all, you know, it's easy for us sometimes to be so focused on our job and getting the facts that we don't sometimes understand just how powerful the story is with you. And so it's good to hear about that. Okay, now, question, next one right here.
Hi, I'm just wondering, do you find it difficult these days that we have news at our fingertips and any moment during the day we have a few seconds, we can glance down on Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook and see a quick line and think, have a knee-jerk reaction, form our opinion, think we have the whole story. Do you find it difficult to deliver the whole story when people think they already know it?
Mm-hmm. Rosie, why don't you try that?
I actually think the reverse happens. I actually think people watch stuff all day, have a sense of what's happening, and I actually think that's why people tune in to TV still, and to shows like Peter's and Ian's and others. I think that people still have a hunger for context and analysis, and I don't think you get that in a tweet, no matter how, you know, good I think I am at tweeting. I don't think I'm giving you everything that you need to know about a story. So I think that people still value that whole pulling back thing. And I also think it's the part that we need to do better, that we need to spend a little more time digging into stories, talking to people, again, going back to that lady's point, that you maybe don't expect to hear from, as Rex was pointing out. I think Twitter gives you a sense of something, but I don't think it gives you an understanding of a story, and I think that's our job.
I have a question against my better judgment for Mark Critch.
I just sent it, Peter.
Using the pseudonym Aaron Berry, Mark writes, why do you think politicians sometimes treat you with more respect and open up more to this hour than they sometimes do to a news reporter?
Well, have you met Ian? I don't know. I'll tell you something. When I first started, the first one I had to do, it was about 15 years ago, and I was doing the show, and Mary Walsh wasn't doing it, and they sent me out. And she would come in, you know, as a dressed with a sword and just berate people, and they'd be afraid of her. And then I was trying to get Mike Harris, you know? And I walk up, hey, Mr. Harris, hi. Hi. He's like, who are you? 22 minutes. What? Where's Mary?
Well, this is going good.
And recently, when all those children were elected to the NDP, I walk up to some fella, he's sucking on a juice box, and I go, hi.
And he's like, oh, hi. I grew up watching you with my father.
And I'm like, oh, boy. And he's like, Mr. Critch. And I'm like, oh, no, how did this happen? I think, but one thing I do over the years, you build a relationship with someone, you know? And you'll have highs and lows, and you will actually earn their trust. Well, I first made fun of Justin Trudeau before he was ever in politics. I said, oh, look, here he is, the Julian Lennon of Canada. And he bristled. And then we went on, interviewed him a bunch of times before the Brazil fight. I boxed him, and I said, you're going to get your face ripped off. And he said, I don't get in anything unless I know I can win it. And he won that, and I thought, what the hell? And then we had a big argument because I snuck a joint into his office, and I tried to light it. And then sent somebody over to Chateau Laurier to say, you can't use that. I said, yes, I can. But they said, no, if you don't use it, he won't do the show. And I was like, oh, no. Not knowing, right? And they said, it makes him look like he's all about pot. And so I typed into Google, Justin Trudeau pee. And it came up, pot? And I said, I'm sorry, but the smoke's already out of the dorm room. And they were like, never again. And I said, fine, but... And then something magical happened, which was an election. And all of a sudden, they're like, oh, we could do something.
But we had a good, so we've had a relationship all over, but over the time, like these people, you build a rapport with people, you know? And I think I'm pretty fair when I have somebody on. I try to talk, we talk to as many conservatives as we do liberals, as NDP or whoever's left. And we, but we get along, but also they know it's relaxed. It's not like Peter Mansbridge shows up, something is wrong, you know? If I show up, I don't know, you might get called a tool or be pied. It's different states.
All right. Told you I wasn't, didn't want to do that. Okay. These are short snappers, and that means it's a yes or no answer.
I don't know the meaning of the word short.
No, don't worry. Don't worry, it's not going, it's not going to you. We've only got 5 minutes left. Here we go. Susan. Have you ever had to lie to get a story?
No.
Tom, have you ever been lied to?
Oh, yes.
Okay. I won't ask you that one, Rosie, because you do a political show. And what's the longest you've ever spent on one story? And I don't mean like an interview time, but we're actually working on a story. What's the longest?
Well, I think my story is just ongoing, like, so my whole life, but the politics. But 6 months. 6 months.
6 months.
Yeah.
Investigative piece of some
yeah,
sort?
Yeah, the piece I did on hostages. That,
no, that's
recently.
Right.
Two Canadians killed.
Yeah. Susan, what's one thing you bring with you in the field?
Mascara.
I thought that's what I saw that
you
night in Syria.
There's a girl in there somewhere. I vividly remember being on the Afghan-Pakistan border in a long black coat, my head covered, putting on my mascara because I have very fair eyes and I will disappear on camera if I don't have my mascara on.
Ian.
Mascara.
I thought he was going to say hairspray.
It's pretty.
No, the anchor of the National does not use hairspray.
Currently.
Have you ever had to kill a story?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Good. We have a very special question here in the audience.
Sorry, we're a little vertically challenged around here in the island. I'd like to direct this question at Rex. You were retiring and you on cross-country checkup, and I got the opportunity to say goodbye to you and ask a question. I can't even remember the question. Oh, yeah, I wanted to know if you were ever late for work, because I'm tragically late for work all of the time, and I think I have a co-worker over here. Anyways, so I promised you that if I ever got the opportunity for you to come to the island, that I would take you out for fish and chips. So, being a good islander, the opportunity still stands.
Allow me, please, to return so gracious a gesture. There is only one, and I mean one, place not only on this entire globe, but within the entire cosmos, that I would agree to have fish and chips other than Newfoundland, except here with you.
Anytime we can provide a dating service.
For those who really need it.
Yeah.
Sexy Rex.
That's right, buddy.
Okay. We only have a minute left. So it's an opportunity for me and for all of the panelists to thank you here in Charlottetown for being such great host to us tonight. Thank you. For all of for all of your questions that came in from the audience and from across social media tonight. It's been terrific to hear them and to be challenged to try and respond to them. I hope some of our answers have given you a sense of what it's like to be in our job. We love our jobs. Journalism is a great and honorable profession, and one that is a fundamental part of the democracy in which we live. And part of doing good journalism is being constantly challenged by our audiences. And so nights like this are incredibly important, and I'm so glad that the CBC has chosen to allow us to do them this year. As I said, we started in Vancouver a couple of weeks ago, tonight here in Charlottetown. In a couple of weeks, we'll be in London, Ontario. We're also going to be in Winnipeg. I think we're going to Yellowknife as well. So we've got a number of places that we'll be stopping along the route each time, coming up with a different topic framed to question journalism in today's age. Tonight was a particular treat here in Charlottetown. We thank all of you here and those watching online. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much.
So you know, can we open the mics again? Yeah, just so you know, we have some food and
stuff,
you know, some really cheap drinks out there in the outside, not outside, but just.